Well, just a quick review from last week. Paragraph A, if somebody was to ask me, what is the bridegroom message anyway? Or the bride of Christ message? You could say it either way. I would make these four points. Although this is not comprehensive, it's broad strokes. It's a call to intimacy with God. And it's a call to intimacy with God by encountering his heart. And what I mean by his heart, his affections, his emotions, but his commitments to us as well. He's made extravagant commitments to share his heart, his home, his throne, his secrets. The third thing I would say, it's not just God revealing his heart to us and sharing it, but it's us walking in partnership with him. He wants us to do it with him. He's not looking for people that will work for him. And that's kind of the common view that we just accidentally fall into. We work for the Lord. But he goes, no, I want you to work with me. I want you talking to me in the process. And I want to rejoice in the way you delight in discovering new things about me. And I want to rejoice in using you and seeing you in action under my leadership. So it's walking in partnership. That's different than just experiencing his emotions. But the fourth thing I would highlight, it's a spirit of abandonment. Meaning the bridegroom message is Jesus gave everything, and he's raising up a bride who gives everything. And the reason that's important to mention, because some people think of the bridegroom message as God's tenderness, and it is. And so they get real sloppy in their life, think, well, he's so nice. I mean, who really cares? But nobody would go to the altar with somebody who says, I'm half in. I mean, you only go to the altar, a man or a woman in a marriage, because you're convinced they're all the way in. So that's part of the bridegroom message, being all the way in, the spirit of abandonment. Well, John chapter 7, I don't think we could cover this verse too many times. Right before the cross, Jesus prays with all the anguish of the cross before him. I mean, sweating drops of blood in just a little while. That's how much anguish. But he's captivated by why he's going to the cross. And he cries out, Father, I desire that she be with me. Father, I desire, I could just imagine this echoing through the corridors of heaven. I desire, it's about her being with me forever. Paragraph B, just in by way of review from last week as well. One of the foundational passages here in Ephesians chapter 5, where Paul makes it clear the church before the Lord returns is going to be walking in the glory of God. It's a victorious church, a glorious church. Now, this isn't just in the resurrection. This is in time and space. There's going to be such a glorious work of the power of God in the midst of trouble, in the midst of the end times. But the glory and the trouble together. And the Lord is going to bring forth a glorious, radically committed church. But Paul tells us one of the real specific strategies of Jesus. He's going to wash the church. He's going to wash our heart from defilement, from boredom, from dullness, from condemnation, from anger, from lust. He's going to wash our emotions with the word. Then in verse 29, he says, let me tell you what I mean. I'm going to highlight how I cherish you. So it's the message of the bridegroom God cherishing his people. That's not the only word that washes. That's not the only word, but that's the word that Paul highlighted here. And that message, in the last 10 or 20 years, I've seen it growing discernible way worldwide. I call it the cherishing heart of the bridegroom God. And you don't have to use the word cherish. But many believers have grown up in a spiritual context where they rarely hear of this part of his heart. But this is the aspect that's going to wash the church in the end of the age. Again, this isn't the whole message. And some people make it the whole message, and then that's out of balance. But it needs to be really at the front as well. When the redeemed feel cherished, when believers, weak and broken believers, feel cherished by the Lord, valued, dear, we run to him instead of from him when we stumble. When we only see that he has power and that he has high standards, which he has really high standards and he's really powerful, but if that's all we see when we stumble, we run from him. We go hide until we get ourselves fixed up, and then we try to present ourselves later. But when we feel cherished, we're empowered to walk in obedience, to resist compromise in a far greater way, because the heart that feels cherished feels alive and valued, and you feel courage to say no to sin then. Even sin that's overwhelming you at the time, if you feel cherished, you think, hey, there's a way out of this, and it's worth it. We're in this together, me and the Lord. Paragraph two. Let's go on to some, now the overview of the Old Testament. Paragraph B, the scripture, as well as human history, they start in the same place. With a bridegroom and a bride in the garden, in a paradise, the Garden of Eden. And the scripture, as well as natural history, ends with a bride and a bridegroom in a garden in paradise. And everything in between the beginning and the end of this scriptural story and testimony and human history, it's about producing a prepared bride for a worthy son. And when we have that paradigm, it affects the way we approach the kingdom of God. We look at being anointed different, because we're not trying to be anointed so we can, wow, look, mom, I made it. I'm anointed. No, we want to be anointed so we can break the power of darkness off of people so they can walk in love, so the bridegroom can, they can feel his embrace, meaning his cherishing heart, and they walk in partnership. We want to be anointed for that reason. We view the kingdom different when we have a bridegroom paradigm, a bridal paradigm. Well, the very first chapter, Genesis chapter 1, paragraph C, we see a really strong statement of the Lord's desire for intimate partnership with the human race. Now, he only has it with the redeemed, but here he makes Adam and Eve, and this is the most startling announcement, in my opinion, the most startling announcement to the angels. He says, let's, the Father, Son, and Spirit are in conversation. There's no humans yet. And all the several scriptures, Job 38 says, all the sons of God, the angels, were singing for joy as they were watching this unfold. And then the Father says to the Son, or the other way around, let's make them in our image. And the angels are thinking, there is no such species, or there is no creation in the image of God that has capacity for deep interaction with God. The angels don't. They're thinking, did we hear that right? Made in the image of God? Why? Where's that going? And of course, God made the very design of the human spirit, the human design, was a statement. I'm going to give them capacity to interact with me in a way far beyond the angels or any part of creation. That was in itself a statement of the end of where this was going, this bridal partnership with the Messiah forever and forever. It was already that statement, I mean, that desire of God is in this statement, the very creative design of the human race. I just can't imagine the angels thinking, did we hear him right? Made with capacity to interact with God at that level? Paragraph one, we have the unique capacity, humans, born again humans, to receive the indwelling spirit. There's no evidence that the angels do. It says, Paul said, that when we're joined to the Lord, when we're born again, we come into this connection with Jesus, we become one spirit with God. Like, what? That his spirit comes to live in us. This is so dramatic. This is part of the design that Adam and Eve were created in. Paragraph 2, the capacity in our mind. We have a capacity for reason, for revelation, for creative thinking, because God is like that. He wants us to share in that part of his nature, our emotions. We have capacity for affection, zeal, joy, all kinds of things that other parts of creation don't have that. We have capacity that surpasses the angels, far surpasses the angels. I mean, angels have joy, but there's no testimony of the angels having holy affection and deep bonding of the heart in the way that humans do, the way we understand affection. Our will has the capacity for dignified actions, to make decisions. We can make decisions, this is remarkable, that have consequences forever. Matter of fact, we make a lot of little decisions all the time, all through the day. And the Lord says, even if you give a cup of cold water in my name, that dignified action has value forever. I will never forget it. I will reward you. Surely I will remember it forever. That's part of being in the image and the likeness of God. And then number 3, we have the capacity to reflect the glory of Jesus' body in our resurrected bodies. All of these were a part of his master plan to have a race within the created order that could have deep heart connection with God like no other part of creation. Top of page 2. This is a snapshot, paragraph D, and I don't know, you know, we have 12 sessions in this class, and I've got like 30 sessions on the bride, so I don't know which ones I'm going to do yet, you know. I'm thinking, but we might get to the 4 women, or we might not, but I want to give you a snapshot of the 4 women in the Old Testament. There's 4 of them, and there might be more, that are clearly pictures of the bride of Christ. And each of these 4 women, again, there could be several more, and I'm not saying this is because, you know, a picture of the bride, you might say, well, maybe her, what about her, you know, well, yeah, I guess put her on the list, yeah, it works. Anyway, these 4 women, they give insight into ways that we relate to the Messiah as the bride. Like Eve, she is a picture of, one translation calls it the suitable companion to Adam. Because you know the story, God puts Adam to sleep, takes a rib out of his side to produce a suitable companion. An eternal companion is the idea. And the Lord, the Father, puts the Son, Jesus, to sleep on the cross, pierces his side, and out of his broken body, he brings forth a bride. And of course, Eve is the picture of that. And the idea is, when you read it, and we may spend a whole session on the picture of Eve. It is magnificent. She's a picture of intimacy, Eve with Adam, with no shame whatsoever, with the fullness of their hearts and beings exposed, with no shame whatsoever. That, and then Paul comes along in Ephesians chapter 5, I have here in the notes, and he says, let me tell you, what happened with Adam and Eve was real. It was historical. It was really Adam and really Eve. But look here at Ephesians 5. He goes, I want to tell you what was really happening. That really did happen historically, but something bigger was happening. God was telling the story of how Christ and his church will interact, that they will cleave together forever, far beyond Adam and Eve. Paul said that was the mystery, the great secret plan that God was working, and he gave the picture in Eve. Paragraph 2, this is a magnificent picture too. I mean, each one of these 4 women deserve a lot of time and attention, but if we don't get to them in this series, you can just study them out on your own. I'm sure there's a lot all over the internet on these topics. Well, Rebecca, you know, there's Abraham and then Isaac. Abraham, he commissions his most trusted servant, the servant who has the most authority, the long-standing record of faithfulness, and that servant is a picture of the Holy Spirit. But Abraham, the father, tells the servant, go find a bride for my son Isaac. And so that servant, that faithful servant that had more power than anybody in Abraham's house, again, a picture of the Spirit, he finds this young, beautiful woman, Rebecca. And when you see in Genesis 24, Rebecca, she was really one intense gal because she had this extravagant servant heart. When Abraham's servant, this, again, picture of the Holy Spirit, he comes to her hometown. He has 10 camels. And this young girl goes, hi. He goes, do you need help? He goes, well, yeah, we've just come through a desert land. Says she ran, and she watered all 10 of them by herself. I mean, this gal's had some arms. 10 camels, and she's running. Then she ran home and said, hey, we got friends. Let's treat them kindly. She has this extravagant servanthood and responsiveness to the Lord. And, of course, the 10 camels, she didn't know. They were just strangers to her. It was filled with gifts that this servant, which is, again, a picture of the Holy Spirit, gives to her. So she's this extravagant, responsive bride who gets adorned with the gifts of the Spirit in great abundance. It's a great, great picture of the bride. Ruth, the different picture. She's a Gentile. She's a picture of God raising up part of the bride out of the nations, outside of Israel. But Ruth, her real characteristics, she was, like Rebecca in some ways, very dedicated. She left everything. She left her father, mother, her family, everything. The idea to go be loyal to the God of Israel and to Naomi. And she went to Israel, and she's a picture, her story of how she was delivered from hopelessness and barrenness, and God honored this Gentile in context to this marriage situation. It's a great story of God raising up the bride among the Gentiles. And then Esther, oh my goodness, courageous. I mean, a picture of courage. But Esther gave all too. That's kind of a theme through all. It's the famous line, when her life was on the line and the life of the Jewish people in Esther's world, in Esther chapter 4, verse 16, she goes, I'm going to do it. I'm going to do the risky, courageous thing. And she, the classic, she goes, if I perish, I perish, but I've obeyed God. And that's the heart of the bride, this courageous, standing up against the onslaught of wickedness. It's the verse, the famous verse, chapter 4, verse 12, you know, for such a time as this, Mordecai, her uncle, says, for such a time as this, you're in the kingdom. Chapter 4, verse 12, and then 4:16, what I just said, she goes, if I lose everything and die, if I perish, I've obeyed God. I'm in all the way. She's a picture of the bride operating in authority with courage and giving all. Anyway, all four of those are dynamic word pictures. But tonight, we're just giving a quick drive-by of the Old Testament passages, so I'm going to keep moving on, but I want to highlight those four, really good stuff in those chapters. Roman number 3, let's go down to paragraph B. Jeremiah, the young, you know, boy prophet, his very first message, paragraph B, God tells this young man, he goes, okay, here's your first word. Cry, paragraph B, Jeremiah 2:2, cry in the hearing of all Jerusalem. I mean, really go everywhere. Tell them this. The Lord says, I remember you, oh, people of Jerusalem. I mean, I remember your forefathers is what he meant. This is Jeremiah. This is about 600 B.C. And Moses was about 1500 B.C., about 900 years earlier. So he's going, I remember your forefathers back in, you know, 1500 B.C.-ish with Moses about 900 years ago. And it says here, I remember the kindness of your youth. And most translations use the word devotion. I think that's the better, almost all the major, many of the major translations. The Lord says, Jerusalem, I remember the devotion of your youth, meaning back when you first came into covenant with me in the days of Moses when I delivered you out of Egypt. You were so devoted there for a while. But I remember it. Now they became rebellious a little bit later. But he goes, I remember those moments in the early days. I remember the, instead of kindness, the devotion of your youth. But here's the phrase. I remember the love of your betrothal. And Jerusalem is going, betrothal? What do you mean? He goes, thus says the Lord, when I called you out of Egypt to Mount Sinai, to that mountain, and spoke from the with the fire of God, it was a betrothal. I was calling you into a marriage relationship. Now, in a betrothal, in the ancient world, was legally binding. When a man and a woman were betrothed, you know, the family came and they exchanged, there's a certain ceremony. They were not actually married. They didn't, the consummation of the marriage wasn't for a year, sometimes longer. But at the betrothal, they made binding covenant commitments to give their all. And when Jeremiah says, Jerusalem, 900, 1,000 years ago, when your forefathers were delivered out of Egypt, God the Father says it was a betrothal. He was making binding covenant commitments to you forever to bring his all into the relationship. I mean, that's like, that was startling. Look at Jeremiah 31 a little bit further, because, you know, Jeremiah 2 is where we start. Now we go later into Jeremiah's ministry. Jeremiah again restates this idea that in the Moses gathering outside of the, after they got through the Red Sea, they went to Mount Sinai and the mountain shook with fire. And the covenant was made, the national covenant, because God made a covenant with Abraham 500 years before Moses, but it was it was for the nation, but he spoke it to just one man. God made a covenant with Isaac and Jacob, but he spoke it to one man. But here he speaks to 2 to 3 million. I mean, it's never happened in history where 2 to 3 million people saw the glory of God and heard God's voice. Nothing like that has ever happened in history. I mean, in the upper room, 120 saw the fire of God, but with Moses, 2 to 3 million heard the voice. And I mean, that's one of the most dramatic moments of human history that I think is easily overlooked and bypassed in our thinking. I look at that, I go, my goodness, what would we think if 3 million people heard the audible voice of God and saw the fire of God and a mountain shake at one time? We'd all catch a plane to go to that place to see if it happened a second time. Maybe. But anyway, verse 32, God says, I made a covenant with you. And when I did it, when I brought you out of Egypt, Jeremiah 31, verse 32, the covenant, you broke it. But what you don't know, it was a covenant I made to you as a husband. I wasn't making a covenant with you as a king. If you serve me, I will treat you well. It wasn't a political covenant. It was a relational one. I was making a covenant as a husband to bring my all into the relationship forever. And Israel was like, wow. Now, the thing that makes this very significant is this is Jeremiah's first message. I mean, chapter 2 is, go, you know, paragraph B, chapter 2. And what's happening is Israel, or Jerusalem, is the people of, because remember, most of you know this, there was a civil war in Israel. And there was the north against the south, and they were in conflict for 200 years. I mean, it wasn't a 10-year war. It went on for 200 years. They were in conflict. And so when you read the prophets, you always got to pay attention. Is he talking to Israel, the northern group, or is he talking to Judah, the southern group, of which Jerusalem and David was in the southern group? The southern group was by far the most obedient between the two. The northern was perpetually rebellious. And most of you know that, but when you read Isaiah, Jeremiah, you know, Ezekiel, Hosea, Amos, you got to figure out, is he talking to Israel in the north Or is he talking to Judah and Jerusalem in the south? Which of the civil war, which groups he's talking to? And here in Jeremiah, he was down in the south in Jerusalem. And there was all kinds of compromise going on. And Josiah, we know Josiah, the young boy king that had a heart for God. It says about Josiah, he loved the Lord like his great-great-great-great-grandfather David did. He was like David. Can you imagine the scripture calling a young man like David some years after David had already, you know, died? This is 400 years after David. God says, Josiah, you're like David. Like, wow. Well, anyway, this young King Josiah wanted to lead a revival, a reform in the nation, and he did. But it's amazing that the great reform that took place under Josiah was in partnership with the preaching of Jeremiah. Jeremiah, boy prophet, Josiah, boy king, they're in league together. And they're in league for some years. But it's amazing, Jeremiah's first message, this is 5 years before the reform takes root. Jeremiah's teaching, your God is a bridegroom God. Your God is a bridegroom God. Look at the relationship through the eyes of a cherished bride. Through a God who made relational commitments, not just political or even commercial covenants. You know, you work this many years, I'll give you this much business and this much ownership in the company. This was not a commercial business, a covenant. This was not a political one for land and those kinds of things. This was a relational one. And so I think it's significant that Josiah's reform was fueled by Jeremiah's preaching and Jeremiah's first message. He was calling them to remember. It was a marriage covenant, a marriage covenant, a marriage covenant. It's more than a king with power. It's more than an official commercial commerce kind of covenant. It's about heart to heart forever together. That's the covenant, and that's the preaching that fueled the reform in Josiah's day. I find that very significant because I believe it's a snapshot of what's going to happen in the generation the Lord returns. He's going to raise up a great revival of Josiah's, if you will, or David's, you know, use whichever name you want. But he's going to have the preaching, the prophetic preaching, unveiling the glory of the bridegroom God in the generation the Lord returns. So this is not a small point here. Look at paragraph C. Well, let's go to the event that Jeremiah was talking about. Jeremiah said, in your youth, or 400 years ago. Now, that's not the exact number. Again, Jeremiah is about 600 B.C. Moses is about 1500 B.C. So, 900 years ago-ish. He's going, hey, let's go back and look at what happened. This is Israel's first meeting with God. And there's 2 to 3 million of them, counting the children and all. And here it is, Exodus 19. You want to know Exodus 19. 2 to 3 million people see the glory of God. Never happened before. It's going to happen one more time when the Lord appears in the sky. And it's remarkable. We're not going to break it down right now, but how many details of this gathering in Exodus 19 are foreshadows, they're tokens of what's going to happen when the Messiah is in the sky. Many of the details are the same. It was a down payment of the second coming. But the reason I'm not into a second coming teaching right now, that's not the point. The point is it was a marriage covenant, a betrothal that was going on. And when Jesus comes with fire and trumpets and glory and thunder and lightning in the sky, it's a marriage declaration, not a betrothal. It's the consummation moment. Well, in Exodus chapter 19, he tells in verse 5, if you, now this is a national gathering. This isn't like just visiting Abraham by himself or Isaac or Jacob solo. You, 2 to 3 million, if you'll keep my covenant that I'm going to make with you right now today, you'll be a special treasure to me above all the people of the earth. Verse 16, then thunder and lightning, I mean, this is going to happen at the second coming as well. Trumpets, very loud. Da, 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 da. I mean, when the Lord comes, the trumpet, I'm sure it won't be that tune, but all over the earth, they'll hear the sound of the great trumpets. Verse 17, Moses brought the people to meet God. What a statement. Like, what? 2 to 3 million people are going to meet God in an open display of his glory? Verse 18, the mountain, smoke, fire, shaking, trumpets, God's voice. Again, very similar is going to happen globally when the Messiah comes back, not for the betrothal. This is the betrothal when the consummation of the wedding is at hand. That's what the second coming is about, because the last prayer in the Bible is the body of Christ in a bridal identity is the bride. Come, Lord Jesus. And he's coming for a wedding celebration. See, it's the Exodus 19 story retold on a global level. Well, just mention it again in the very same message, Jeremiah 2 and 3. It's the first message. Remember, it's 5 years before the great reform of Josiah. Although the reform wasn't that great because it ended up after Josiah died, a bunch of them backslid. And so, but it was a real reform. It just wasn't that long lasting. When the king died, the people went back to their compromise. But look at again what Jeremiah, he's still in that first message of chapter 2. Now he's at chapter 3. It's one big long message. He goes, return, O backsliding Jerusalem. And again, 5 years later, the reform happens. So this is the preaching before the revival using our terminology. Why should you return? Because I'm married to you. Why should you return? Because you'll get in trouble if you don't? He says, that's not my main message. Because of who I am and who you are to me. Don't you see who you are and who I am and who we are together? Return with that knowledge. Beloved, I think that kind of preaching, the Holy Spirit is going to anoint that message. They may not use that terminology, but it's that bride, the Spirit and the church in a bridal identity in the generation the Lord returns before the Lord meets them in the sky. Top of page 3. Well, let's go on now to Hosea. Hosea, there's, not that you have to get this down, but I like this kind of stuff, but not everybody does, but just bear with me. But Amos and Hosea are the first two prophets talking. Amos and Hosea. They are about 20 years before Isaiah. So those, it's Amos and Hosea, and then about 10 or 20 years later, there's Isaiah, and Isaiah starts as a young man. But anyway, that's just a little context. Here's why I want to tell you this. Hosea, now this is about 120, 150 years before Jeremiah. So this is 100 plus years, 150 years before Jeremiah. So no one has ever said bride of Christ yet, you know, in the scripture. Hosea is the first one, and 10, 20 years later, Isaiah comes and trumpets it as well. So those were the first two voices. I mean, I just think, what would it be? I mean, the first man in redemptive history to declare it under the anointing with revelation, Hosea. And again, he's about 10, 20 years before Isaiah says it. Maybe a few more. Nobody knows the exact dates, but just a little bit. Well, paragraph A, Hosea's life, oh my goodness, was so challenging because God wants him to be the bridegroom prophet to reveal the Messiah as bridegroom. Great. Well, Hosea, there's a downside to this calling, being the first man to reveal the bridegroom God in a very direct way. Not a hint, but a direct way. What's the downside? Well, Hosea, I want you to feel what I feel. Okay, I'd love to feel what you feel. Oh, not so quick, Hosea. Not so quick. He goes, here's what I want you to do. It's a very unique story. He goes, I want you to marry a prostitute. And I want you to love her. I want you to fall in love with her. I want her to break your heart.
He's going, I'm listening.
Then I want you to patiently wait and love her. And then when she's sold into slavery because of her bad choices, take your hard-earned money, buy her out of slavery, pay her debts, bring her to your home, and love her loyally with no guard, fully, with all your heart, for the rest of your life.
Oh, wow.
And then you will feel what I feel when I look at my people. And you're the first one, Hosea, so that's your calling, but I want you not to give doctrine. I want you to cry out of your heart with feeling. Because that's my story with my people. So he says it here in Hosea chapter 1. Again, Hosea's first message. And remember, he's about 20 years before Isaiah, who's the second guy to say it. Verse 2, Hosea chapter 1, verse 2. Then the Lord began the very first message of Hosea. Hosea, take a wife of harlotry, a prostitute, and have children knowing that there's going to be adultery and immorality. But they're your kids. Take them all the way. Hosea's going, man, how's it? Right now, I'm an anointed, holy prophet of God that's been dedicated. He goes, I know, that's why I chose you. I can trust you. Okay. I can trust you to make known to the nation my heart. Okay, Lord. Is this like going to stretch on for a year or a little bit longer? Oh, a little bit longer. A little bit longer. Paragraph B. Hosea, he goes on in the message. Now, this is the Lord speaking through Hosea. And this is part of the end of the age message as well. He says, Hosea, tell the nation this. I'm going to hedge up the nation with thorns. And I'm going to wall her in so she can't break out and go do these destructive things. I'm going to take away options. I'm going to hem her in. Do you know how horrible it is to be hedged up with thorns? Like I'm hedged up here. Everything. Ow. Oh. Ah. No. Whoa. Whoa. Hang on. I might get through this. Ouch. That's what thorns, hemmed in with thorns. He goes, I'm going to wake her up. Verse 7. And for a while, just like your wife, Hosea, she's going to chase her lovers. But I'm going to make it difficult for her to find them. I'm going to put obstacles in her path because I love her. I'm not going to make her love me, but I'm going to create the optimum environment where she goes, this isn't worth it. This is not worth it. Then she will say, look at this, this is profound, verse 7, Hosea 2. I'm going to return to my first husband. I'm going to return to the Lord. Because it was better for me when I was with the Lord than it is now. And this very intense message, the Lord is saying to Hosea, I'm doing this even historically and globally. I'm going to even hem in my people. Israel, I'm talking about unsaved and saved in the body of Christ that's living in compromise. I'm going to wake up my people, and they're going to say, it was better for me to be radical for the Lord than it is going outside of his leadership. I look at that message, I go, ooh, intense. Well, the reason that Hosea is this bridegroom message, because we can only understand the difficulty, we can only understand the judgments, the redemptive judgments, not the punitive. The punitive is just judgment because they're wicked to remove their wickedness. Redemptive, I mean, to remove them out of the way because they won't repent. That's punitive judgment. Redemptive judgment is God saying to the ones he loves, I'm going to wake you up. I'm not going to make you choose me, but I'm going to create an environment where it will be better for you to choose me. That's redemptive because he loves his people. But only if you understand the bridegroom heart can you see the wisdom of what he's doing. Other than that, it's like, why did God let that happen? He goes, I'm a bridegroom. Read Hosea. Read Hosea. I'm a bridegroom. I'm in it for love. That's why I've hemmed you in with thorns. Paragraph C. It says, well, he's still in the same chapter, chapter 2. He goes, verse 13, I'm just jumping right into it, not wanting to give a verse by verse of the whole chapter, but we will do that on Wednesday night in a little while. But anyway, but me she has forgotten, verse 13. Verse 14, but you know what I'm going to do? I'm going to hem her in, but that's not all. I'm going to allure her. I mean, how extravagant. She's writing me off. I'm hedging her in with thorns. I'm walling her up, but I'm going to lure her too. I'm not just going to show her what life is like outside of my leadership. I'm going to allure her. I'm going to show her my kindness, and I'm going to speak to her heart and draw her to me. I'll speak comfort to her. Look at verse 16, one of the great passages in the book of Hosea. And in that day, talking about in the generation of the Lord returns, is a fantastic promise. You will call me my husband. My plan will work. And my people will see the wisdom of being wholly mine when they understand I'm actually their bridegroom God. And I'm in it for love. Paragraph D, we're in the same chapter. I mean, Hosea 2 is intense. It's really a good chapter. Look what he says in verse 19. He says it three times. 19 and 20. He goes, just so you know, this is right after he says, you're going to call me my husband. Israel, you're going to declare to the Lord, Lord, Messiah, you are my husband. You're going to say that. He goes, I'm mark my word. I'm going to make it clear, and I know you will. Verse 19, he goes, let me tell you a little more details. I will betroth you to me forever. Now remember the betrothing, I'm going to make binding covenant commitments to you to give all of my heart. I'm in it all the way. You're not a workforce. You're not a political contract or a treaty. It's a covenant relationship of bride and bridegroom. I'm going to betroth you. Then he stops. He goes, yes, you heard me right. Because Hosea, he's the first one to ever say this. Yes, I said betroth me. Because remember, Jeremiah was like 150 years later. They're going, betroth? Really? He goes, yes, in righteousness, justice, kindness, and mercy. And then he says it the third time, I will betroth you to me in faithfulness. What a remarkable deal. What he says in righteousness, just a thought, just a phrase on each one of those words. I'm going to betroth you to me in righteousness. He says, in what I'm doing in this marriage relationship is I'm going to cause righteousness. Everything that's right is going to unfold. There's nothing amiss. This isn't a cruel marriage. This isn't a trick. My methods, my motives, my end result is going to produce righteousness in people. They're going to love and do what's right all the way through the process when they see it. This is no fake marriage where you find out, oh, no, it's the marriage disaster beyond measure. No, it's going to be filled with right things forever. He says, I'm going to do it in justice, with justice. He says, I'm going to wake you up, Israel, and he says the same thing to the body of Christ. I'm not going to be too severe, but I'm not going to be too lenient. I'm going to talk to you and wake you up in justice. My son paid the price, and I'm not going to violate your free will. I'm going to do this in justice. I'm going to wake you up. Then he says, but don't be afraid of the justice, because I'm going to do it with loving kindness, with tenderness. I love you. I'm going to show you my love. Then he goes, and in the process, you might be going, oh, I'm weak, I'm broken. He goes, I'm going to fill it with tenderness. I'm going to be exceptionally merciful to you. I'm going to give you a far better deal than you deserve. And then he says, in faithfulness, I'm going to keep every single promise I ever made. I'm going to show you that this marriage relationship, I am so reliable. I am the husband that will do everything I promise to do forever. Not one disappointment will happen when it all unfolds in that perfect day. Then he goes on in paragraph E, still in the same chapter 2. His first message, here he is. I call this his bridal gift, paragraph E. He goes, I'm going to change the atmosphere and completely heal it. I'm going to change the agriculture, make the whole earth like the Garden of Eden. I'm going to change the animals. I'm going to remove all war and have peace in the nations. I'm going to make an environment for this relationship of such blessing. You can't imagine how good the setup will be when I have my way in the earth. Well, paragraph F, he says, now, Hosea, you got the message. Now we're chapter 3, but it's the same message. He goes, you got it? You got the message, right? You're going to marry a harlot. You got the whole deal, right? Now I want you to do this. Go again. Love her. I know she's committing adultery, but love her like I love Israel, because I want you to feel, but not just that, I want you to be a picture of how I feel. It's got to be real and authentic. Verse 2, well, she got herself in a lot of trouble, and she's an indentured servant. She has X amount of time to serve because she got in all this financial debt. Pay off her debts. Buy her back. Free her, I mean, from her debts. Bring her to your home and love her. And then in verse 5, he says, and Israel is going to follow suit, and we're going to live happily ever after forever. Verse 5. It's not exactly what verse 5 says, but that's what it means. Top of page 4. Other passages, there's a few more I could put on here. I'm going to skip the one in Ezekiel, but Ezekiel basically tells Israel, I gave you beauty, royalty, splendor, fame. I blessed you, but you misused it. You misinterpreted the blessing as something you created. And the Lord's message through Ezekiel is, I'm blessing my people, even the body of Christ, but they don't understand it, and they take it for granted, and they get empowered to go live in compromise, and they don't realize it was me that was setting up good things for them. Paragraph B. Well, we have the Song of Solomon. I mean, we have the whole 8-chapter love song, so it's kind of difficult to pick one or two verses, because you could pick 10 or 15 verses. Because Song of Solomon, 8 chapters, it's a love song, and it is depicting the glory of the beauty of married love. I mean, natural married love. It's a poem about natural marriage. But the Holy Spirit uses that poem that extols the beauty of married love and says, but there's a bigger message. It's not limited to how King Solomon loves his new bride. There's a bigger message. There's King Jesus who loves his bride. And in this, verse 9, one of the highlight verses where we see the heart of the bridegroom in the storyline. Now, in verse chapter 4, Song of Solomon 4, verse 9, she has just made extravagant commitments of dedication in verse 6. And then he responds in verse 7 and 8, and then he says this in response to her dedication. You have ravished my heart. When the Lord sees weak and broken people in the flesh, but responding to the grace of God with dedication, he doesn't say, well, you ought to. I died for you. I mean, it's about time. He goes, no, you moved me deeply. You move me when you obey me. In verse 10, oh, I love verse 10. He goes, this is the Lord speaking. How beautiful is your love to me? And he flips it. He says, your love is better than wine. Because remember in Song of Solomon in the very first chapter, the bride says, your love is better than wine. Here in chapter 4, the Lord flips it. He goes, you know what? I got something to tell you. Your love is better to me than all the good things of this world. I want the love of my people. Paragraph C, the great Psalm 45. It's the story of the bride responding to the bridegroom. We can't go into it, but just to make a point, verse 10. Because verses 1 to 9 is about the bridegroom and his glory, the most beautiful one. More fair than all the sons of men. More beautiful than any man that's ever walked the earth. And all of his composite qualities, the Lord Jesus. Now, verse 10, he says, okay, now to the people who respond to the king. Now we know as the bride of Christ. He goes, verse 10, listen, O daughter, because of the glory of this king, forget your own people. Forget your father's house. And if you do, verse 11, the king, described in verses 1 to 9, the beautiful king, he will greatly desire. He will see beauty in your dedication. Now, this passage, forget your father's house. Now, Jesus isn't anti-family, of course. That's not the context. But we know in Luke chapter 14, the famous verse in verse 26, he goes, if there's a issue of loyalty between your loyalty to me and your loyalty to your father, mother, son, daughter, husband, wife, whatever, you must have such loyalty to me that you could even say you hated the others by comparison of the intense loyalty. And Jesus, I have no doubt, is actually referencing this verse of the bride of Christ. You know, here at the end of paragraph C, just the writing, I want you to see this. The only thing that the Almighty God does not have that he wants. There's only one thing he doesn't have that he wants, but he refuses to take it by force. He has all the power. He's got all the muscles. He goes, I can take anything I want by force, but I won't take this. That's your voluntary love. He goes, I want that more than anything, but I won't take it. I will wait for you to give it. What a remarkable reality. But he says here in verse 11, to the bride when she, her loyalty surpasses the loyalty of her father's house and her own house. I mean, it just means all of her heritage, everything, her loyalty to the Son of God. It says the king will be deeply moved, not by the physical beauty, it's not the idea, by the beauty of that dedication. He alone sees how glorious that kind of dedication is. The king will greatly desire your beauty. Well, let's bring it to the end here. Isaiah, oh, we love Isaiah. Remember, he's about 20 years after Hosea. Hosea is the first one to talk about the bride. Isaiah is the second. So he says in verse 4, Roman numeral 6, Isaiah 54, verse 4, he addresses fear and shame. He goes, don't give in to fear. Don't be overcome with shame. Well, why? How can I be free of fear and shame? He roots it in the revelation because your creator, your maker, your creator, the Genesis 1 God is your husband. So as your husband, this was startling to Israel because Hosea's up north 20 years earlier saying it, and Isaiah's down south saying it. So I'm guessing this might be the first time the guys in the south, the people in the south ever heard this. Because again, Isaiah's up north and, I mean, Hosea's up north. They don't have email and they don't have a good mail system. I mean, I don't know for sure if it's their first time, but this is a radical idea. He goes, your maker, the transcendent God who's holy other than, who's holy other than, he is so superior in his might and power, but he doesn't just have power. He has desire. He has desire for relationship. This was startling to them. The Genesis 1 God isn't just a king. He's not just the Lord of hosts. He goes, he is the Lord of hosts. He's a warrior. He's the God of the armies of heaven. The Lord of hosts means the God of the armies of heaven. He's a warrior. He's going to fight for you against your enemies. He's the God of all the earth, it says here. He's the Genesis 1 God, but he's more than powerful. He's your husband. He's committed at the heart level forever. And he says, when you feel forsaken and grieved and shamed, know who it is you stand before. Hebrews 4:16, come boldly, come boldly. It's not just his blood is sufficient, it is. I mean, that's a good enough statement itself, but it's more. His heart desires you. He goes, not just I stamped your passport, I'm invested in your heart. Yes, my blood covers, but my heart longs. So Hebrews 4:16, come boldly. Body of Christ, not in shame, not grieving. I mean, because of your failure. I mean, there is godly sorrow. Grieve over it. I mean, we look at our negativity. We say, Lord, that's not good. But the Lord says, repent of it and come before me with clarity and boldness. I said this last week, paragraph 3. The bridegroom, I love the idea of the bridegroom king. He's a king with power, but he's a bridegroom with desire for relationship. That's a phrase I'd love a lot of you to take that phrase when you go and you're discipling and training other people. He's a king with power. Everyone kind of gets that, but he's a bridegroom with deep desire for relationship. The bridegroom describes who he is, what his personality's like. The king describes what he does. His king is his function and his position. His bridegroom is his nature and his personality. He's not a king who happens to do bridegroom stuff. He's a bridegroom who does king stuff. He goes, my heart, that's who I am. That's my nature. By nature, I'm a bridegroom. By function, I'm a king. And I love the king. I love the revelation of the king. But I don't want to lose the heart when I'm appreciating and valuing the power. The good news, we don't have to pick. We don't have to pick between heart connect and power. We get both when we say yes to Jesus. And then I'll end with the grand verse. Hosea 62, a few chapters later. He brings it up again, verse 4. He goes, your name is no longer left out, forsaken, broken, left behind. That's not your name. Your name's Hephzibah. That's your name. And Hephzibah means the Lord delights in you. The Lord likes you. He delights in the relationship. Beloved, I want you to put your name in that. You. Bill, Tom, Susie, Lizzie, you. Your name is God delights in you. Beloved, you want to take this before the Lord and say what God says about you. Well, what do you mean he delights? Verse 5. In the way that a bridegroom rejoices over a bride, so God delights in his people. But his people aren't all mature. But I'm talking about the sincere that are saying yes to his leadership. The Lord says, I delight in the relationship. You know, it's interesting that the very next verse, verse 6, up here in Isaiah 62, that's the famous verse, night and day prayer. I set watchmen on the wall, night and day, night and day, night and day. And I love to tell this story. I've told it for, you know, ever since, I don't know, since 1996 when I had that, 1995 when I had this dream. So how many years? 20 years ago plus. I had this dream. I've said it already every class, but I love to say it. Where the Lord spoke audibly in this dream. He says, call them Hephzibah. Tell them I delight in him. And I was down at the Kansas City Convention Center. And I was saying, Hephzibah. And these young people, it was shifting their emotional chemistry, meaning that this truth, I don't mean me just saying it, but the truth of it was the symbolic part of the dream. This truth would change their emotions, the way they carried their heart. Oh, and I woke up and the power of God was resting on me. It was such a powerful feeling. I went, oh my goodness, I just encountered the Lord. It's about 5 o'clock in the morning. And I'm just like, oh, it's a Sunday morning. And I had a message ready. I said, throw that message away. I know what I'm going to talk about. I heard the thunderous, audible voice of God. I mean, how many times have you heard that in your life? Hephzibah, I delight in you. So I've preached on Isaiah 62, 6, the next verse, many, many times over the years. God calls intercessors, watchmen, night and day, night and day, night and day. I may have talked that the night and day, the prayer movement, night and day, night and day, night and day. Okay, verse 6 and 7. I never noticed verse 5. Never. Nah, I'm embarrassed. The verse before. Well, the two verses before. So I get up that Sunday morning. I am so excited. I'm so invigorated with the presence of God on me. I wish this would be like this every day instead of not enough. I go, oh, I love it. I go, where is that Hephzibah verse? I know it's in the prophets. I'll try. because I got my Bible marked up and stuff. So I said, I bet I marked it. So Isaiah 1, I go, say 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, Isaiah 23, 24, 25, 26, Isaiah 56, 57, 58, 59, 60. What's Isaiah 62? When I get to Isaiah 61, I go, to save time, I know Isaiah 62, so I turn the page over. I really do. And Isaiah 63, Jeremiah 1-3-4, Ezekiel 1-3-4, Daniel 1-3-4, Hosea 1-3-4, Amos 1-3-4, Job, blah, 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 Malachi. To me, like, whatever spirit of inspiration I've had, I'm so frustrated, it's all gone. I said, how can that be possible? Huh. And it's marked. I said, okay. I'm looking now, it's getting later. You know, I got to get ready for the Sunday church service. Like, okay. Isaiah 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 58, 59, 60, 61. I'm running late, 62, so I flip it over. 63, 64, 65, 66. Malachi 4. I'm exhausted in front. I go, ah! So when all else fails, man, look at the map. Go ahead and get directions. So I open a concordance. Hephzibah. Isaiah 62. I go, impossible. The concordance is wrong. I know Isaiah 62. I preached on that 100 times. So I turned to Isaiah 62. It's the verse before, the night and day verse. I go, when did that get put in? Oh, my goodness. And what I did not understand is the night and day stuff of verse 6 and 7 of prayer, you can't sustain it without the bridegroom revelation of verse 4 and 5. And people visit from all around. They go, hey, how do you do this? How do you organize it? How do you blah, 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 blah. I go, oh, I could give you a few little points on that, but that's not the big stuff. If the people are not energized by who it is they're talking to, not just a God of power, but a God of desire, they're not going to sustain the night and day. The night and day of verse 6 and 7 is rooted in the bridegroom revelation, verse 4 and 5. Well, amen and amen. Let's stand.